child.
Right. See, basically, when you have a small right ventricle, the left ventricle is always going to be a very dominant chamber. And as a result of which, as sir said, the axis tends to get leftwards. And that is what I showed you, that in tricuspid atresia or pulmonary atresia with intact septum, you will have a leftward axis with counterclockwise loop. The only way to differentiate it from AV canal is to look at the R waves in V1. And if you have prominent R waves, it's most likely because of AV canal. And if they are small, then it's most likely because of tricuspid atresia. I don't think that really the causes are known, although people have attributed it to the hypertrophy of the moderator band.
Hello.
I'm not sure that that is the cause of sudden transition, but that's just an observation that the R wave suddenly drops and S wave becomes prominent between V2 and V3, which is characteristic of tetralogy of Fallot. Mm-hmm. Really speaking, it's very difficult. Once the isomerization sets in, it becomes very difficult to say at what level the shunt is. But if you find that there is a wide pulse pressure, if you find that there is a EDM, because truncal valves, as you know, are dysplastic and can cause truncal regurgitation, and if you see some evidence of suprasternal pulsations, one of the differentials would be isomerized shunt at the AP level. But whether you can swear and say that this is truncus or whether this is ductus isomerized is very difficult. Because as you know, even in ductus isomerized, you will have suprasternal pulsations. You can have early diastolic murmur because of pulmonary regurgitation. And as you know, once pulmonary regurgitation sets in isomerized ductus, the narrow pulse pressure again starts widening. So to differentiate clinically, a truncus arteriosus isomerized from ductus arteriosus isomerized can be quite tricky.
One of the clue can be if you see a right aortic arch.
Absolutely.
It's very likely that you see a truncus.
Yes. So clinically, to make a diagnosis of right aortic arch may be difficult, but on radiology, as sir very rightly said, that truncus arteriosus, you will have almost 25% or sometimes even more with right aortic arch, which is quite uncommon with patent ductus arteriosus. So that can be another clue to what pathology you are dealing with. And of course, echo and other imaging modalities will clinch the diagnosis. Really speaking, the degree of cyanosis is not a great indicator as to differentiate whether it is truncus arteriosus or whether it is single ventricle. But what can help you is that in truncus...
Vis-a-vis the age of the patient,
right,
the degree of cyanosis, whether a ductus would isomerize at what age? Say you get a 10-year-old with severe cyanosis and all those signs, then you would...
I think
if
that what
clinically you want to put your...
Yes, what Praful is trying to say is all these admixture cyanosis which get isomerized much early in life. So they may get isomerized at the age of 6 or 7 years, whereas patent ductus arteriosus may get isomerized at a later date, although that is not a rule. The second thing that can
differential
help
differential.
The differential cyanosis in patent ductus arteriosus is more likely, whereas in truncus arteriosus, because the mixing is at the level of the ascending aorta, the cyanosis will be distributed equally in all four limbs. So that could be a good clue to differentiating patent ductus arteriosus from truncus arteriosus. Presence of ejection click canal. Once isomerization syndrome sets in, you can have ejection click just because of pulmonary hypertension, and may be difficult to say whether it's a truncal click or whether it's a ejection click because of dilated pulmonary arteries. Yes.
Another thing could be purely a single second sound.
Yes, sir.
Go in favor of
a truncus arteriosus because there is only
loosely split second sound.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And
absolutely.
You may see on the X-ray a pulmonary bay.
Absolutely.
In a patient with a
patent ductus arteriosus. Whereas usually the pulmonary arteries are not very well seen in patients with truncus arteriosus because main pulmonary artery is almost absent, and it's the branches which come out of the main trunk or aortic trunk, whatever you want to call it. But second heart sound can be extremely useful. If it is single, it would go more in favor of truncus arteriosus, whereas a narrowly split second heart sound would almost always mean that it would be a patent ductus arteriosus. But these are some of the things that you must know, and you must know that there are limitations. So at times, you can only go this far and no further. You were asking me something. I agree with you. I don't know whether I can tell you what level of hemoglobin would mean anemia at what level of saturation. But I think on peripheral smear, if you ask a hematologist or a pathologist, they are good at telling you whether there is microcytosis, whether there is anisocytosis, whether this is normochromic, normocytic. If you feel that this is the kind of peripheral smear that you have, and if you feel that the hemoglobin is less than, say, 15 grams or 14 grams per cent with saturations which are in mid-70s, then probably you could say, or you would be justified in saying. But if you ask me whether 14 is anemia or 14.5 is anemia, I'm not sure that I can tell you based on the level of hemoglobin alone. I think that, as I said, that if you have associated microcytosis, if you have associated hypochromia, I think it's time to correct this anemia. Otherwise, based on symptoms, if you feel that the patient is disproportionately symptomatic as against the anatomical subset, then probably if you see the hemoglobin of even 13.5, 14, probably you would like to give a trial with iron supplements and see whether it responds or otherwise. But otherwise, I'm not sure what is the exact hemoglobin level at which you would say that this child is anemic. And just to talk about polycythemia, since we are at anemia, many times this is asked, is phlebotomy a treatment? So as you know, unless there is a clinical evidence of hyperviscosity based only on hemoglobin, it's not a great idea to bleed these patients. And another important thing, when you bleed these patients, there is always an increased incidence of hypoxemic insults in the post-phlebotomy period. So the family needs to be counseled properly when you undertake phlebotomy in these children. And all phlebotomized patients need to have a replacement with normal saline.
I think, thank you very much, Bharat, thanks for an excellent presentation. And now I think we really go to the real world scenario in the mock form. The first case presentation, who's the candidate presenting the case? Please come. And the patient? Raful?
Hello, hello. 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 Hello.
Dr. Shrikant, I'm third year resident from my hospital.
Please talk loudly so that people can hear at the back. Your name is Rahul. Shrikant.
Okay. My name is Dr. Shrikant. Yeah. I'm from my hospital.
Marks also, huh?
16-year-old male patient named Lalit Kumar Harijan, resident of Uttar Pradesh, studying in ULAN class, with informant being patient's uncle and patient partly himself. presented with the chief complaints of palpitations since 6 years and fever since 3 months. History of present illness. Patient was apparently all right 6 years back. To start with, patient noticed to have palpitations which were gradually onset, regular in nature upon doing daily activities like going to school, which was about 500 meters from his house, which corresponds to the NOHA class 2. The palpitations were relieved by rest in a short period of time. There was no history of syncope. For these complaints, patient was shown by his uncle to local doctors in UP, where he was given medications which the patient took for a period of 15 days, but his palpitations persisted. 1 year after, patient developed fever which was high grade, associated with chills and rigors, continuous in nature. It was not relieved by oral medications which are given by the local doctors. So the patient was brought by his uncle to JJ Hospital, Mumbai, where he was evaluated in the form of chest x-ray, 2D echo and blood investigations, and was told to have heart disease for which he would require surgery. Patient was admitted in the hospitals and given IV medications for a period of 4 weeks. Patient's fever subsided. Patient was advised surgery, but patient didn't undergo surgery because of financial constraints. Patient's palpitations continued at the same intensity for 4 years since then. Since last 1 year, patient's palpitations have increased to the extent that patient is able to appreciate his palpitations while doing activities like getting up from the bed, walking up few steps and doing activities of daily course. Patient is able to appreciate his palpitations even on lying down position. He is able to appreciate pulsations in the neck regions also on lying down position. Since 3 months, patient is having again fever which is high grade, associated with chills and rigors, continuous in nature. There is no history of cough with expectoration, rash, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. For these complaints, patient was shown to the local doctors in Uttar Pradesh, where who gave him tablets which the patient took for a period of 3 weeks, but the fever persisted and symptoms were again not relieved. So patient was brought by his uncle to Nair Hospital, where he was evaluated in the form of the 2D echo and blood investigations. Patient's blood samples were taken from the three different sites. Patient was started on IV medications and hospitalized. Patient was hospitalized and was started on IV medications. After 3 to 5 days, 3 to 4 days, patient's fever subsided. Patient was advised surgery for his heart disease in Nair Hospital. There was no history of joint pain, joint swelling. There was no history of paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. There was no history of recurrent low respiratory tract infections in childhood. There was no history of rash, petechiae, hematuria. There was no history of CVA, abdominal pain.
You started off talking to us about palpitations. Now, palpitations in, meaning you, his first presentation is palpitations. So what comes to your mind when a patient complains of palpitations? You said they're palpitations, you got the history of being regular, he can feel it at rest and increases on exertion. So what comes to your mind at this point in time?
So basically palpitations, I would like to think of in terms of volume overload conditions.
Okay, like?
Like aortic regurgitation. At this age, the possible etiology being bicuspid aortic wall.
I'm not asking you etiologies, just palpitations is the symptoms that the patient is giving you. So what all comes to your mind as you talk about palpitations?
Aortic regurgitation, then VSD, PDA, then patients with AV canal defect with MR, then anemia.
So like how do you want to characterize palpitation? Like palpitation in general historically can be characterized into three groups. Like, so one you said is volume. What are the other conditions, other etiology that you would like to fix up? Like, one is because of volume overload. What are the typical volume overload palpitation historically?
They are associated with bounding pulsations in the precordium as well as pulsations at in the neck.
So are they exertional? What is typically described, like what is typical description of a volume overload pulsation? When do they better perceive it, like? They may be exertional, but they perceive it much more when they are lying down in a quiet down, quiet room, like when
which
before
you,
they.
Which you did mention. Yes.
So that's what are the other types that you want to categorize, like in terms of palpitations, like.
Palpitation, they can be because of arrhythmias.
Arrhythmias.
If they are irregular, associated symptoms.
So how do you distinguish a palpitation due to arrhythmia?
They are sudden in onset. They are irregular. They are associated with symptoms.
Maybe
like
maybe regular also, but they are sudden in onset and offset. That historically will give you a clue about this thing. What are the other third type of palpitation? Yeah. It's due to heart failure. So how does the palpitation due to heart failure differ from a palpitation due to volume overload?
So the patient has.
It is like dyspnea. That palpitation due to heart failure is because of tachycardia, low output that happens in exercise and immediately comes down with. Rest, like it's like a typical kind of a dyspnea equivalent kind of a thing that happens, like so that as you described, this is more likely to be a volume overload palpitation.
So along with palpitations, do you ask for any other histories? What happens during palpitations? For instance, you're talking about arrhythmic palpitations. So arrhythmic palpitations, you talked only about irregular in this context of the patient. Maybe you're talking about irregular palpitations, sudden onset. Regular palpitations, you can actually ask the patient to mimic what the palpitations are like in terms of doing this. And he will be exactly be able to, many an intelligent patient, especially when there is a frequent palpitations is the presentation, the arrhythmia clinic palpitations that we talk about. They can actually mimic and tell you how the onset is, how it terminates suddenly. So sudden onset, sudden termination gives clues to arrhythmic palpitation.
This also can be helpful in determining whether what kind of palpitation. Most of the volume overload palpitation need not be at a very faster rate. Like.
Yeah.
That is because of
so
mostly
the rate,
due to the force.
The rate pressure. And the regularity of the palpitation, the patient can mimic it for you.
So can you use NYHA classification for palpitation?
Yes, sir, NYHA class.
What are the other conditions apart from dyspnea that you can use for the NYHA class?
Fatigue. Angina, dyspnea, palpitations, these four conditions.
So what is the WHO functional classification? So where do you use it?
Does anybody here know?
Pulmonary hypertension. How is it different from NYHA classification? Instead of?
Yeah.
So that's specifically used in what are the other functional classification that you know of?
Specific activity scale.
Specific activity scale. And Canadian classification.
Canadian classification.
Canadian angina.
Can you grade the specific activity scale? Anybody can?
But less than 5 METs, and the 4 is he cannot perform activity which is more than 2 METs. Less than 2 METs.
All right. Can you apply that for palpitations now? And at this age, what could be the reason for his palpitations?
This age, because of volume overload conditions. So, predominantly because of regurgitant lesions.
You said onset of palpitations 6 years ago, which were relieved by rest for a short time. So, what does what that very significant at that stage, 6 years ago, and how much time did it take to progress to class 3 or class 4 now? She's in class 4 now.
It took about 5 years.
But then you said 4 years ago he was already class 3.
He was class two at about 6 years ago. Year he is having palpitations upon doing daily activities like getting up from the bed. Corresponds to class 3. So about 5 years it took.
It took 5 years for him to become class 2 to class 4.
Class.
You said at rest he is symptomatic, right?
Yes.
So So what conditions at this age of 16 years you think of? With no, with a history of fever on and off, being treated with antibiotics for a short time and getting relieved.
So the fever.
So did the fever worsen the symptomatology, in other words? Fever is one of the precipitating factors for heart disease to worsen. In his case, did the fever 3 months ago worsen the symptomatology? That's important.
Patient doesn't give history, the symptoms are worse by fever. If it would have been because of infection under gastritis, usually such patients present with acute onset of...
What other thing can happen? He's how old? 16.
16 years.
16. Infective endocarditis is one way. What is the other ways the fever can worse? Fever coming. Activity, no? Activity in a rheumatic. 16 years you get activity?
Yes, sir. Yes.
You can get, right? We need
fever
from your history to understand. You gave importance to the fever, you talked about IV antibiotics and all. So extremely important that the fever has worsened the symptomatology or otherwise, isn't it? So that you ought to be able to point out in your history itself. The fever is all settled, everything is fine with him, or what do you think about the fever basically?
So actually the fever is very high grade. It is associated with chills and rigors. It is continuous in nature. The fever is not associated, and it was relieved by IV medication. It was persistent for about 1 month. So such a high grade continuous fever, usually we get in condition of like infection.
With no focus anywhere. You gave all those important negative ones to rule out
no
fever.
Of, burning
and suddenly I noticed you are very haphazard in your what you are trying to point out, important negative history. Do it all together. You suddenly talked about a CVA or what, meaning in what context you are talking about, we ought to understand that what were your important negative that you gave history-wise. So what were you trying to rule out? Can you come out again with all that negative history and try and tell us as to what you were hinting at?
Sir, there was no history of joint pain, joint swellings, no history of intramuscular injection. So yeah, the fever of rheumatic fever is less likely. Then there was no history of dyspnea, orthopnea or paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. So the fever, if such a long fever, if we're thinking in terms of infected endocarditis, so it can lead to the acute perforation of the wall leading to acute aortic or mitral insufficiency leading to the PND. Then complications of IE like rash, petechia, hematuria, and CVA, that is embolic phenomena, embolic manifestation, complications of infected endocarditis.
A few things that you could have brought out much nicer, it will be like initially to start off with, was the palpitations were there before the onset of the fever episode, first episode.
Yes.
Why is that important?
Started off with palpitations apparently.
Why that is important, like?
That fever is not the contributory factor for that.
So this is not a heart disease that has actually come into work because of an infected endocarditis.
Yes.
So it was there, some disease was there, and that got infected endocarditis. But how was he doing in between, like? Was he doing all right? Was he able to go to school or?
He was able to go to school. He was able to do his daily activities for about 4 years. He was relatively asymptomatic. Since 1 year, his palpitations have increased.
So because we are dealing with a volume overload condition, as you are suspecting, the two important history that you should have brought out will be, was he advised penicillin prophylaxis?
He was not advised. He was evaluated in tertiary hospital and he was told surgery at the discharge and he was not given intramuscular injection penicillin.
So that should have come out in the forefront, like that you should have told in the forefront that
that you are ruling out rheumatic at least as one of the things, right?
That's number one. And number two, was he ever told to have a hole in the heart in the early childhood? Because that's a very common history that you can find, like somebody would have told a hole in the heart, because picking up a small VSD will be a very easy thing in childhood.
Patient's uncle told that he was told in his language that he was.
It is a very important history. You should have come out in the front, like you should have said that even despite that, patient was not advised a penicillin prophylaxis, and the patient was told to have a hole in the heart at 4 years of age or whatever it is. So these are extremely important history that that will be very useful in your defense, like or whatever way you think.
And also the other cardiac symptoms, what happened? Does he have any other cardiac symptoms besides palpitations? You only talked about palpitations.
There
what
was
about
shortness of breath?
There was no complaints like shortness of breath, no history of paroxysmal dyspnea, no history of hemoptysis, no history of edema of it. Other symptoms are not there.
So at that time when he had the first episode of fever, or first episode of infective colitis, or second episode of infective colitis, was does he had any symptoms of right heart failure?
Patient doesn't give such history.
So why that is important, like in this case, like for example? A VSD with worsens with infective endocarditis, what is the likelihood like? He either could be a VSD with TR or VSD with AR or could be a VSD with an RSOV. So that will help you in deciding which is likely.
So now putting your history together, what is your differential diagnosis? All long cases, at the end of long case presentation, you have supposed to have found. That's why I have not even gone and examined them. So we are perfectly pure people that way. We don't know what the diagnosis is. And what all is coming to my mind should come to your mind, in other words. So tell us now, just on your history, you have also, of course, examined the patient. So you would be getting biased about that. But always, always in an exam, after your history taking is done, you jot down as to what do you think, where will you fit this history into, without having known what is the examination findings at all. So tell us now, 1, 2, 3, 4, as to, so, or you have just one diagnosis or whatever you have.
So basically, he is a 16-year-old male presenting with the palpitations which were class 2 6 years back, that were progressed to class 3 since one year, and there were two episodes of high grade continuous fever for which he required IV medications for a period of 6 weeks. So at this age, considering his symptoms as predominant symptoms being palpitations, I would like to think in terms of regurgitant lesions. The first, I would like to think in terms of aortic regurgitation. Possible etiology being, as the patient was told, the history surgery at the age of 10 years, and he was told like holding that. So first VSD with AR, then it can be secondary because of bicuspid aortic wall.
See, etiology wise, why are you just jumping? We had a lecture on congenital heart disease, so first thing comes to your mind is VSD AR. AR as being the etiology of congenital this thing, you just go away from what you have examined him as. So the common things first, no? You talk about what he never gave us a history of congenital heart disease in the childhood. So he has aortic regurgitation because you think the palpitations are so overt that he can see it. So you just want to talk about regurgitant lesion as being aortic valve. So that's the mechanical aspect. Etiology wise, what is commoner? You've not got any history of congenital or otherwise.
VST.
So why not rheumatic heart disease here? What percentage of patients give you the real rheumatic as a distinct?
You think it is not
because
rheumatic?
He did not get an intramuscular injection as a penidura prophylaxis. That's why you want to say.
50% patients do not give history of joint pains.
Yeah.
Then you know that. So.
So then you tell us all those things, no? Just don't jump to VSD AR as the first this thing. On history taking. So regurgitant lesions is one thing. What about shunt lesions?
Yes, it can be secondary to shunts like VSD, PDA, moderate sized.
No, it could be just patent ductus arteriosus. Can't it be?
Yes.
And that can't that have an infective endarteritis or something, pulmonary wall endocarditis or something like that. So you got to club both together and tell us. You understand?
Whether you sit in your clinic or you present a case in the examination,
it should not be any different.
There are three steps of making diagnosis. Number one, they are grilling you on the history, right? The four examiners, all of them are university examiners. They are grilling you on the history. So first you have to make a diagnosis which is a historical diagnosis. On a historical diagnosis, you cannot make an anatomic diagnosis, because anatomic diagnosis you're going to make after you examine the patient. Here you can give, say, only hemodynamically relevant diagnosis. Like you have got palpitation can be either arrhythmogenic, can be because of some hyperdynamic circulatory state. So you can't say this aortic regurgitation until unless you examine a patient and find out he has an aortic regurgitation, or you find a pansystolic murmur with a mid-diastolic murmur, you don't know this is a VSD or not. So I think you have to give